This nondescript little house in downtown Regina was once home to a man leading a double life. By day, John Leopold was a mild-mannered painter, but at night, he worked as a spy for the RCMP.
In the 1920s, the federal government saw communism as a very real threat to the Canadian way of life. The Russian Revolution had just ended, and Western countries were terrified the Red Menace would spread. The government ordered the RCMP to infiltrate communist groups and radical labor organizations across the country. Most of them were made up of Eastern European immigrants. That's where John Leopold came in.
You have Mounties that can't go in the meeting halls because they're going to stick out like sore thumbs. Because they don't speak the language, they don't even have the right accent. And so you need people from within these groups that can spy on their own numbers.
Steve Hewitt is a mounted police historian. He says it wasn't easy researching Leopold's story, even 50 years after the fact.
It's not the sort of material that the mounted police or the Canadian Security Intelligence Service wishes to give out. They want to protect the identities of informants and sources and undercover operatives, so it's extremely difficult to get.
Hewitt managed to find Leopold's RCMP application. He was one of the first recruits in the fight against the commies, and an unlikely one at that. Not only was he 4 inches too short to qualify for the force, his foreign accent and appearance didn't really fit the RCMP image, but the Mounties needed someone who could go undercover.
He had all the characteristics of the menace that the Mounties were fighting against, and yet he wanted to be on the side of the Mounties, so he was the perfect person to send in to spy on these groups.
Leopold signed up and was sent to Regina in 1919. He assumed the identity of Jack Esselwine, house painter. Over the next 9 years, Special Agent 30, as he was known, joined as many radical labor organizations as he could. He even helped organize a local branch of the Communist Party. He typed all his reports in a safe house, well away from where he lived. But the stress of Leopold's double life took its toll. He lived in constant fear that he would be exposed, and his communist cronies would wreak some sort of horrible vengeance on him.
Huh. Here's a list of the alcohol that he consumed in a single week, because he claimed the expenses. It's amazing, in a single, he claimed he needed it, because at that time he was working
undercover. Two bottles of whiskey, one bottle of whiskey. He's drinking a bottle every day.
Yeah.
Leopold became careless. His cover was finally blown when he made a stupid mistake.
Leopold wore out his regular shoes, so he started wearing his mounted police shoes, which unfortunately on the bottom of the soles had RCMP written on. And he was sitting at a party meeting, and he popped his feet up on the table, and there on the bottom was RCMP.
Leopold's fear of retribution was unfounded. All the Communist Party did was send him this letter, formally expelling Jack Esselwine from the party. Leopold was posted to the Yukon and forced into uniform for the first time. But his knowledge of communist groups eventually landed him a job in Ottawa, in charge of intelligence.
John Leopold's brief career as a spy was only the beginning of the RCMP's undercover activities. The force has had agents and informers working in Canada ever since, at all kinds of subversive places, including here, the University of Saskatchewan. For the CBC NewsHour, I'm Bill Waiser.